Hello everybody. My name is Kyriakos Haralambous, and today I'm going to present to you a work that me and the research group at the Developmental Psychology Lab at the University of Cyprus have done. The title of the study is Comparing Short-Term Growth in Conventional and Cyber Forms of Bullying in Early Adolescent Students. So the big question here is to see whether how short-term fluctuations in conventional bullying and victimization compare to that of cyberbullying and victimization. But before I proceed, I would like to first to make to address an invitation, taking this opportunity to invite you all to. we are hosting the 22nd workshop of migration in Limassol. This is my hometown, actually. It's going to be held on the 23rd. Till the 25th of November, and we'll be happy to see you there. And I resume. So the purpose of the study were the main purpose was purposes were three. Like I said, we're going to investigate and compare short-term growth in levels in the levels of conventional and cyber forms of bullying. Secondly, we wanted to examine how growth in one form of bullying or victimization affects growth in the other forms. And we also wanted to see the effect of gender and schooling level on the growth rates of the cyber and conventional forms of bullying and victimization. Why is our study significant? Bullying and victimization, as you all know, constitute a significant problem in school-age children and adolescents. And with the internet usage growing exponentially, much attention has been drawn to cyberbullying, which is an extension of conventional bullying, but it's been done through electronic media. Now, cyber and conventional forms of bullying share some common features, such as aggression, perpetration, power imbalance, and repetition. But they also have some inherent differences. For example, in cyberbullying, there is a potential anonymity of the perpetrator. There's no time and space constraints. The bullying act might be visible to a larger audience, and there's no immediate reactions from the victims in cyberbullying. Now, despite the growing interest in this, in comparing bullying in its conventional form and in its cyber form, there are some significant gaps in the literature. There were two studies that examined growth and compared growth in cyber and conventional forms of bullying. But these studies used a six-month time lag, and the other one used a one-year time lag. Both studies found that significant that cyber victimization were more fluctuated more than conventional one. Like I said, apart from these two studies, there is a limited amount of research dedicated to address the differences in the growth of conventional cyber forms, especially with short-term studies. And when I say short-term, I mean studies with using a 1 month time lag or 6 weeks time lag, such as the one we did here. Also, no study has comprehensively examined how growth in one form of bullying affects that of others. And this is particularly important in our opinion, because if short-term fluctuations in cyberbullying are there, then by using a one-year time lag or a six-month time lag to study this phenomenon may not be able to tap these fluctuations, and then what we are actually measuring is not what's what's going on between the year or the 6 month interval we are examining. So we had 861 participants. As you can see, mean age was 13. Our sample was divided in terms of gender and almost equally divided in terms of grades. We had half our samples came from elementary schools and the other half from high school. The instruments used in our study were the BVQ revised and the personal experiences checklist questionnaire for measuring cyberbullying. Procedure. First, we secured permission from the Cyprus Ministry of Education. We conducted randomly selected schools. We formed participants and we got informed consent from parents and students alike. And then the administration procedure took place. There were four different administration phases. The first phase took place in December and the last one in April. And the time interval between each wave was 6 weeks. Let's see the results for a bit. There are some descriptive statistics. What we can conclude from here is that there are significantly more variation in conventional forms of bullying rather than cyber forms. And the major questions of the study were examined through latent growth curve models. Here you see the model one. We have each form of bullying. We had conventional bullying, conventional victimization, and cyberbullying, cyber victimization. Two latent variables were for each form. We have intercept, which showed the initial levels, and the slope, which showed growth. Intercepts were regressed on each measured time point, and we set the loadings to one, and the slopes were regressed again on each time measurements. With slope in time one, slope was set at zero, and this is our anchor value. And at the last measurement point, time four, we set the loading to three. So we didn't put any loadings, we didn't set any loadings for time two and time three, because we weren't sure if the growth would be linear or not. So we wanted the analysis to, the results to tell us what kind of growth we would have. All intercepts in all four variables were said to be correlated, and all slopes, and intercepts and slopes for the same form of bullying were also said to be correlated. Results show that conventional victimization had the highest initial value, followed by conventional and cyberbullying, whereas cyber victimization had the lowest initial value. Of course, because the questionnaires used for cyberbullying and conventional bullying were not immediately comparable, this finding is not that solid. But what's more important is the second one, in which we found that conventional bullying and victimization showed no significant change during the four measurement points. But on the other hand, we have a significant change in cyber victimization and cyber bullying. Also, for conventional bullying and victimization, the higher the initial value in time one, the lower the increase. So if a student had high bullying levels in December, his growth during the four time periods would be lower than a student having low bullying levels at the same month. Now, this pattern is a common psychological law, the law of initial values, which, as I said, seems to hold true in our study for conventional forms of bullying and victimization. However, for cyber forms of bullying and victimization, this law seems to did not apply. So there were no relation between initial values and subsequent growth in cyber forms of bullying and victimization. Initial values for all four variables were positive correlated, and the slopes, the growth that is, for all variables were again positively correlated. So if a student had high levels of bullying in December, he would be more likely to have high levels of victimization, cyberbullying and cyber victimization. And at the same time, if a student had a positive growth in any form of bullying or victimization, he would be more likely to have the same growth in the other three forms. Next, we examined another model. We entered gender and educational level as time invariant predictors. And results for model two showed that girls had higher initial values for conventional bullying, cyberbullying, and showed greater change in conventional victimization. And in terms of classroom level, students in higher grades showed a greater change in terms of all conventional bullying, conventional victimization, cyberbullying, and cyber victimization levels. Which means that for high school students, the fluctuation in all forms of bullying were more significant. And for students in lower grades, elementary students that is, higher initial values were found to be in place in terms of conventional bullying. What do we conclude from our study? There was an interesting question yesterday at the last night keynotes. I don't know if you were there. Patricia asked whether we believe that cyberbullying and traditional bullying differ, or if they're the same. Well, this particular study shows that cyber and conventional forms of bullying do differ in some, they carry some unique features that make them considerably different from one another. First, we see that cyber forms of bullying and victimizations do fluctuate in short-term intervals, whereas conventional forms seem to not have this fluctuation for the same time. And conventional forms of bullying seem to adhere to common psychological principles. If you have higher levels of bullying at time one, then your growth in bullying should be, growth levels should be lower. But cyber forms of bullying seem to not, do not adhere to this principle. So there are considerable differences here. On the same time, despite these differences, we see that both conventional and cyber forms of bullying go hand in hand. If a student reports high levels of bullying or victimization, he is more likely to report higher levels of cyberbullying and victimization. And also, if a student reports growth in one form of the phenomenon, he is more likely to report growth in the other three forms. We also see that gender educational level differences are in place in all four forms of bullying examined in the study. Some implication we might want to derive from these findings. It's pretty obvious that the relation between conventional and cyber forms of bullying is complex and warrants our further investigation. This is one of the first studies that actually examined the short-term fluctuation differences. The results are very promising, but we are sure that we need further investigation to corroborate these findings and to extend them. We also understand that the widely adopted long-term interval examination for cyber forms of bullying might not be appropriate to tap short-term fluctuations in this phenomenon, which seem to be present. Another implication is that while gender and educational level seem to be significant predictors of all forms of bullying, there is still significant variation remained unexplained, so other variables need to come in place to see where these variants can be attributed. And of course, additional short-term and mixed method studies will be required to confirm and extend the findings of the present study, especially in terms of the differences we found in the two forms of bullying and victimization. Okay. Thank you very much for your attention. I hope everything was clear to you. Okay.